Hey guys, how are you? I'm Rahul. So today we're going to start a new chapter of the economic survey, climate change and sustainable development. So let's move ahead. So this slide actually will represent you the summary of the whole chapter. And what are the 2015's landmark international events in the field of climate change is, first of all, climate change agreement was signed under the auspices of UN framework on climate change in Paris in December 2015, which aims to keep the rise in global temperature well below 2 degrees Celsius, very important, till 2100, that is end of 21st century, the temperature should be kept below 2 degrees Celsius rise, so that we can have a low carbon resilient and sustainable future. Fine. Then the second one is that we have adopted the sustainable development goals in September 2015, and then these goals will set the developmental agenda for the next 15 years. If you want to read about the Paris Agreement as well as the sustainable developmental goals, so I would suggest you can find these both in the by search option in our website www.decipherIS.com. Fine. And also you will find about all the sustainable developmental goals, etc., and their analysis. But climate change agreement I will deal here completely also, because it is there in the economic survey. But SDGs are not much in this survey, so you can read it from the website. Then the economic survey talks about domestic initiatives. These are launching of historic international solar alliance and submission of ambitious intended nationally determined contribution, that is INDCs. And these all will be dealing later, but first of all we are going to deal with the main two agreements, that is climate change agreement in Paris and SDGs. So coming to the Paris Agreement, it was signed in the Conference of Parties, that is 21st Conference of Parties. Now, it sets a roadmap for all the nations in the world to take action against climate change in the post-2020 period. Now, you should remember that it is for post-2020 period, not 2015, 2019 is not included in this agreement. Fine. Then it seeks to enhance global action against climate change. Global action against climate change and limit the global warming, that is prevent the release of greenhouse gases. But while reflecting the principles of equity, that is equality with difference. How can you define equity? One definition I can tell you is equality plus morality. That is, wait a second. Equity is equal to equality plus morality. Equality suggests that everybody should contribute equally in combating climate change. But morality tells, because the developed countries historically have led to huge amount of greenhouse gas emissions, so they should contribute more in the terms of technology as well as the finance. So this is called common but differentiated responsibility, that we are also responsible for the climate change. We should also work towards preventing climate change, but developed countries have much more responsibility than us, and we should also take account of the respective capabilities. Like suppose China is way ahead of us, so it has more capability to deal with climate change than India. Fine. Because we have different national circumstances. We have a lot of poverty in India, much more than even Western Sahara. Fine. So let's move ahead. Now it also seeks to elicit an ambitious action by basing on a country-driven approach, that we will decide. I will decide that how much I can reduce. It will be not be top-down but bottom-up. Fine. Now coming to the SDGs or Sustainable Development Goals, Now, Millennium Development Goals were till 2015. India was able to achieve some goals and it was not able to achieve some goals. Now, it is guiding the international community and national governments on a pathway towards sustainable development for next 15 years. I am talking about the SDG here because its time period is from 2016 to 2030. Now, there are 17 sustainable development goals and 169 targets we need to be achieved under the 17 goals. And it is widespread. It deals with equality, environment, industry, governance, what not. Everything is included in SDGs. That's why it is sometimes called that it is very generic. Now, on the domestic front, that we have announced in INDCs. India has also announced, and many other countries have submitted their INDCs, which sets the ambitious targets for domestic efforts against climate change. Like we have agreed to reduce the emission intensity by 33 to 35% of our GDP by 2030 as compared to 2005 levels. Fine. Now also we will also try to achieve 40% cumulative electric power installed capacity from non-fossil fuel based resources, as we are focusing more and more on solar and wind. Solar we have to reach by 100 gigawatts by 2022. Fine. So 2015, according to World Meteorological Organization, was the warmest year with temperature 1 degree Celsius above the pre-industrial era, like before the 1800s if we talk about. So this was owing to first El Nino and second the warming caused by greenhouse gases. You know what is El Nino? That will be dealing in the geography lectures later, but still I can tell you a little bit is that Western Pacific Ocean and Eastern Pacific Ocean. So this Western Pacific Ocean is nearby Australia and Indian Ocean, okay, and Eastern Pacific Ocean, here we have Peru, Chile. So normally the warming happens in the Western Pacific Ocean and more rainfall here, and here cold Peru current flows. But in the times of El Nino, the warming happens near the Chile and Peru. So because of this, we have more rainfall here and hot current flowing, but here we have dryness. Fine. So this is the cause of this is also the cause of increase of 1 degree Celsius temperature. Now if we talk about the greenhouse gas emissions, energy sector is the largest contributor to the greenhouse gas emissions. Anthropogenic emissions have been increasing at the unprecedented rate since the Industrial Revolution. And according to the International Energy Agency report, concentration of CO2 in 2014 is 40% higher in the mid-1800s. That is, in 1850, suppose I take emissions as 300 tons. But in you can say in 2015 it has reached 300 plus 40% of 40% of 300, so it will become 120 plus 300, 420 tons, and it is currently approximately this much only. So energy sector is the largest contributor, and in that also CO2, carbon dioxide, has the largest share. Now the global emission profile shows that the emissions have been distributed very unequally among different countries. If historical CO2 emissions from 1970 to 2014 are considered, India with 39 gigatons, you can see here, India with 39 gigatons is way behind top 3 emitters, that is USA, EU and China. China has 176.2, USA has the highest 232, and EU has 190. This is historical, that is from 1970 to 2014. Fine. And here there is absolute emissions in 2014, and here what we have is per capita CO2. Here also you see India has the lowest per capita emission, approximately nearby 2 tons per capita, and what we have for the EU is is 6 to 8 tons or 6 to 8 and a half tons per capita, and for the US we have 15 to 18 tons per capita. For China we have like 6 and a half to 10 or approximately 9 and a half tons per capita. So the USA's emissions were around 6 times India's, even if we consider historical levels. And only present levels are, when only present levels are considered, both in terms of absolute and per capita emissions, India is way behind the three major CO2 emitters I have just told you in this figure. Fine. So let's move ahead. Now the average Indian is accountable for only 1.6 tons. I have just told you, here it is 1.6 tons. If I am telling you exactly, it is 1.6 tons. And for China, I don't have the figure, but for USA we have 16.4 tons as average per capita emission. Fine. For European Union we have 7.4 tons. China would be having approximately 7.8 tons. Fine. So in 2014, what does it tell us? China was at the top in terms of absolute emissions, that is total emissions brought out by the country, while in terms of per capita, USA was at the top, as you can see, 16.4 tons, and India's per capita emissions are among the lowest in the world. So if the different levels of development and differentiated responsibilities and equity are considered, USA's highest per capita CO2 emissions and per capita income also, as you can see in this graph, USA has very high per capita income, approximately $50,000 per year, while India has only, you can say, $1,000 or $2,000 per year as per capita income. China has a little bit more, approximately $8,000. EU has $35,000 or $36,000 as per capita income. So US has the most of the responsibility to bear these effects of climate change and contribute a lot. So when if we consider sector wise emissions, so in terms of sectoral CO2 emissions, we can see the highest contributor is electricity and heat production. On an average in the world, it is 42% contributing to the CO2 emissions. Like the we have thermal power plants and all. In China it is 49%, in India is the highest, 51% is through carbon dioxide emissions is from the electricity and heat production. Now this tops in all the countries, but if you consider the second number for CO2 emissions in India and China, it is manufacturing industries and construction. See, 31% in China, 26% in India. But if you talk about EU and USA, we have transport as the second largest contributor of CO2 emissions. USA has 33% and EU has 26%. So these compositional patterns reflect the different priorities of these countries. Now coming to the Paris Agreement, the 21st Conference of Parties under the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, successfully concluded in Paris after a lot of negotiations and adopted the Paris Agreement post 2020 actions on climate change. Now this universal agreement will succeed Kyoto Protocol, and it provides the framework for all countries to take action against climate change, and hence places emphasis on climate justice and sustainable lifestyle. Like sustainable lifestyle, if we talk about India, we have much more sustainable lifestyle than USA. USA wastes a lot. It uses 30 times more resources than India, 30 times than Indian people. So there is no justice at all for wasting these resources, as it is useful for sustainable development. Fine. Now focus should be that we should hold the increase in global average temperature to well below 2 degrees Celsius and above pre-industrial level, if that is if we talk about the 1800s, before 1800s, and it should not increase 2 degrees Celsius above the 1800s, And we should also try effort to limit it even further to 1.5 degree Celsius. That is, it should not increase more than 1.5 degree Celsius. Fine. Now, Paris Agreement has 29 articles which deal with all these points that we are going to deal with in these slides. So it covers all the crucial areas identified as essential for a comprehensive and balanced agreement, including mitigation. Mitigation is reducing the effects of the pollutants or pollution, adaptation, changing the technology so that we emit less, then loss and damage, finance, technology development and transfer, capacity building and transparency. So a persistent theme which flows through the Paris Agreement is that of the balance. In this agreement, it was recognized that the global peaking of greenhouse gas emissions would vary for developing countries, parties. For example, China will peak much earlier than India because it is emitting much more. So once they reach their peak emissions, then rapid reductions would take place forthwith so as to achieve a balance between anthropogenic emissions by sources and removals by sinks of greenhouse gases in the second half of the century, that is after 2050. And it will be based on the basis of equity and in the context of sustainable development and efforts to eradicate poverty. Fine, understood. Now, moving ahead, that we are having a marked departure. Obviously, we are having a marked departure because now the nations are deciding that how we are limiting the contribution and how much we have to limit the our emissions. Fine. So coming to the salient features of the Paris Agreement. Now these are very important. These sum up the whole agreement. Now recognizing right to development of developing countries. Paris Agreement recognizes the right of development of developing countries and their efforts to harmonize it with environment while protecting the interests of the most vulnerable. Who are the most vulnerable? These are the low-lying areas, for example, you can say Madagascar, Maldives, etc., which are poor countries and are island countries, or also which are big countries and having low-lying coastal areas, for example, Kolkata. Fine. So here the second point is we have to deal with these principles and we deal with climate change with the help of principles of equity and common but differentiated responsibilities with respective capacities in the light of different national circumstances. Now we should also communicate to the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change climate action plans that we are going to take, that are called nationally determined contributions. And every 5 years we need to submit this so that we can find out what is the progress that is happening, and each country will be persuaded to reach more target than the previous one. So it is kind of transparent thing. Then this agreement is going to come into effect in after 2020. But this doesn't mean that we should not take action at all before 2020. We should also take action before 2020. Now, developed nations should increase their financial support to reach the goal of $100 billion. For so long, they are trying to reach this goal, but USA and EU are not ready to give their money, though they are the most responsible for contributing and bringing us to this situation. Also, this 100 billion is a new quantified goal, which is a base level, that is minimum that we should have. After that, we should raise more and more so that we can enhance our climate change prevention efforts. Fine. Then developed countries should provide financial resources to the developing countries. They have not mentioned, but we should also write that we should also provide, that is, developed countries should also provide the technology so that emissions can be reduced. Very important. For example, supercritical coal technology, that will reduce the carbon dioxide emission in the coal-based thermal power plants. then we should have robust transparency framework for both action and support, because previous and all, anything and everything, and loan also, if a developed country is giving, it was including it in the $100 billion basket. Actually, it is giving for its own benefit to get interest, but it was including it as a finance, which it was not. So starting in 2023, a global stock take, that is, evaluation will happen, covering all the elements, so that we can see that how much collective progress we have made in these years. Now, it also establishes a compliance mechanism overseen by a committee of experts that operates in a non-punitive way. You should note here that it operates in a non-punitive way and is facilitative in nature. When you are non-punitive, how can you coerce or force the countries to contribute money into it? This means that USA will keep polluting and it will not listen. It even didn't accept the Kyoto Protocol. That is, it didn't ratify it. So it was not bound by the Kyoto Protocol. And there is no foundation on USA, and it can easily say that I didn't sign it. So this is the case with the environment. So Paris is only the beginning of the shift towards a low carbon world, and hence we know that we have to do a lot more to prevent the climate change. So thank you everyone. Please like, comment and subscribe to www.thecipheris.com.